This is a Hot Pie Media original.
Drinking again and thinking of when you loved me. I'm having a few.
Let me set this up for you because I'm about to nerd out, about to geek out. And yes, there's a purpose behind playing that song. If you don't like that, go away. Get out of here. That is Sinatra. If you didn't know it's Sinatra, then it might be my favorite Sinatra song. I could nerd out right now on the depth of that song. I've liked it for a long time. It's sort of off the radar for most people. But if you know the story of Sinatra and you're about to know more, then you'll fully appreciate Drinking Alone, which I think is... might just be, it might be my favorite Sinatra song.
Sure, I can borrow a smoke.
I think I have all the Sinatra books, and I think it's safe to say these are the definitive Sinatra books. If you don't know that I'm a fan, a nerdish fan, who even was there to celebrate his 100th birthday, by the way, in Vegas, there's a life-size picture of him right behind me. James Kaplan has written a few books about Frank Sinatra. One, Sinatra, the chairman of the board, and the other, Frank the Voice, and they are off the charts good. He's with me now. James, can you hear me okay?
I hear you perfect, Jeff. Can you hear me?
I can. I don't know if you heard the lead in there. It is probably my favorite Sinatra song, and that is Drinking Alone, which I think that's Sinatra captured in that entire song, the depressed Sinatra that you know about.
Are we talking about Drinking Again?
Drinking Again, yes.
Drinking Again. Drinking Alone is another song.
Yeah, it's another song. I know.
That's
Drinking Again is for years being a Sinatra fan and nerd, knowing his story, I feel like there's something really in Sinatra in that song.
Yeah, well, there's something in Sinatra in I would say in most of his songs. He worked really hard, really, really hard on putting something of himself, a lot of himself, into all his work.
I spend all kinds of time talking about the songs themselves. Let's get the sensational stuff out of the way right away.
Yeah.
His relationship. Well, first of all, put it in perspective. You know, sometimes I think when I'm at his family's bar there in Vegas, and I think I cannot imagine Frank Sinatra in a social media world. That would be a train wreck, I think. What do you think?
Absolutely. I think that he would have none of it. He was an in-person guy. Not virtual, actual, in all his relationships, even if sometimes it was at the point of his fist. He was a physical man. He was an emotional man. He wouldn't have put up with anything virtual.
Yeah, so I don't know that there's a comparison, but again, I'm a huge fan, so it's hard for me, a larger-than-life figure like Sinatra, I can't find a comparison. But make the argument of the significance of Sinatra, not just as an artist, not just as a singer, but a cultural icon and this unbelievably powerful force. I don't know of any stars that we've had that have had that many different aspects to them like Sinatra.
Yeah. Well, it's because the world has changed. The world has changed into a world of a million tribes. And it was a different world in Sinatra's time, and that was virtually the entire 20th century. You know, it was the American century. It was also Sinatra's century. He was born December 1915, Hoboken, New Jersey, in Coldwater Flat in Hoboken, New Jersey. There were cobblestones on the streets and horse-drawn carriages. December 1915, he was born, and he died on May 14th, 1998, the night of the Seinfeld finale. So there you have the American century.
I've never thought of that.
Yeah, and no other. It's impossible to think of another figure who was connected to so many different strands of American life, politics, popular culture in the 20th century.
His relationship with the Kennedys. And how it went, I don't even know if it's fair to say it went south, but his relationship
very much
with the Kennedys and how it went at best to say cold. How and why, and where does Marilyn Monroe fit in all of that?
Marilyn Monroe has less to do with Sinatra's relationship with the Kennedys than you might expect. But Frank and Jack Kennedy met at the Democratic National Convention in LA in 1956. And for Frank, it was love at first sight. He fell head over heels for this young senator who was at the age of 39 in 56, a plausible presidential contender. And this was a guy who was, Jack Kennedy was brilliant, charismatic, he had class, he was a Harvard graduate, he was a war hero. He was everything that put stars in Sinatra's eyes. And Kennedy, in his own very cool and reserved way, was rather interested in Sinatra and got much more interested when he began to run for president in 1960. They really cemented a friendship, or the beginning of a friendship, in Vegas in 1960 when Jack Kennedy came through, partly to campaign, but mostly to have fun. And it was a relationship that lasted, I would say, not much more than a year and a half. Sinatra planned, organized, and virtually created Jack Kennedy's inaugural gala in January of 1961. But by that time, he was already behind the eight ball where the Kennedy family was concerned. Jack's brother, the Attorney General, Robert Kennedy, did not like Frank Sinatra and particularly detested Frank's friendships, shall we call them, with mob characters. The relationship began to sour around the time, during the campaign, because Jackie Kennedy also, she thought Sinatra was a thug, which is ironic since about 25 years after that, she and Frank actually dated. But she thought he was a thug, and both she, Jackie Kennedy, and Bobby Kennedy were in Jack's ear constantly telling him to dump Sinatra. And Jack Kennedy, being the ultimate pragmatist, more or less did that. But the straw, the end, the decisive break happened in spring of 1962. Jack Kennedy had been planning to go west, ostensibly to inspect an Air Force base and some new planes and missiles. But where he was really going, since Jackie was touring India at the time, the cat was away and the mouse would play, Jack was really going to spend some time at Frank Sinatra's Palm Springs house and have some fun there. Bobby Kennedy put his foot down. Bobby Kennedy knew that there was this woman, Judy Campbell, who was having a relationship with the head of the Chicago mob, Sam Giancana, and also having a relationship with Jack Kennedy. And this had all been kind of brokered, to put it into nice language, by Frank Sinatra, who introduced Judy Campbell all around. And Bobby Kennedy told his brother, you cannot stay at Frank Sinatra's Palm Springs house. You can't. It is going to look horrible. This guy is in bed, almost literally, with the mob. He's in bed with the mob, with the head of the Chicago mob's girlfriend, and you can't go there. And so Jack Kennedy changed his plans. Instead of staying at Frank's house in Palm Springs, he stayed at Bing Crosby's house. This was a huge public humiliation for Frank Sinatra, and he never really got over it. He blamed Bobby for it more than he continued to idolize Jack Kennedy. But that was pretty much the end.
The mob relationship, first of all, who put together the Rat Pack? And then the Rat Packs, which I'm a huge fan of. If people were to go back and watch those videos, there is no way you could pull that stuff off today. It wouldn't last one half of one show. Not only was the act over the top and outrageous, but incredibly talented, entertaining. So who put together the Rat Pack and the Rat Pack's relationship to the mob as they pretty much made Vegas what Vegas became?
Yeah, well, I'm afraid you're talking to a guy who, after spending a lot of time looking into the Rat Pack and everything Sinatra connected, is not a great fan of the Rat Pack. There are actually two Rat Packs.
Right.
The first Rat Pack began in Beverly Hills in the mid-50s, and it was created by, it wasn't created by, it was just a bunch of people hanging out with Humphrey Bogart and his young wife, Lauren Bacall, and hanging out, drinking a lot, saying clever things. And one night when they were all three sheets to the wind, Bacall, young, salty Bacall, looked around. She said, you all look like a Rat Pack. And the name stuck. But that was Bogey and Bacall and people like Ira Gershwin. That was a totally, and Sinatra was involved in that, but it was a totally different ball of wax. The second Rat Pack, and the one that has created the myth, and I underline myth, happened in Vegas in early 1960 as Sinatra and Dean Martin and Joey Bishop, Peter Lawford, Sammy Davis Jr. were shooting Ocean's 11, that terrible, terrible movie. It was really the inmates taking over the asylum. There was an ostensible director on that movie, an old man named Lewis Milestone, who was a respectable director. But Frank took over the whole thing. And they weren't called the Rat Pack. They weren't called the Rat Pack. That was laid on them by the press. It was the second Rat Pack, what they were billed as in Vegas at the Sands in 1960 was the Summit. Jack Entrotter, the head of the Sands, in which Frank owned a share, scheduled this great series of shows. So one show, and these were late shows at the Sands, would feature Frank solo, and the next one would feature Dean solo, and the next one would feature Sammy solo. But what began to happen, since there was a lot of fooling around, and this was fooling around that Jack Kennedy dropped in on while he was campaigning, was that the first thing that happened was that Dean heckled Frank during his show. Now, Frank took himself very seriously. And anybody else in the world heckling Frank Sinatra would have probably vanished into the desert. But Frank Sinatra idolized Dean. And he took it, and there were a lot of jokes, and there was a lot of drinking. And soon the Summit, which had been scheduled as sequential shows for each of these big stars, became all of them on stage, fooling around, ad-libbing, and drinking on stage, and making all kinds of politically incorrect remarks. And yes, we have some video of that, and you're right. It's so far from anything that would be tolerated today that it's almost perversely fun to watch. But that was really it. It was just a couple of months in Vegas in the beginning of 1960 with Jack Kennedy out at the periphery of it and sometimes dipping into it. And these guys, Frank and Dean and Sammy, and then peripherally, Peter Lawford and Joey Bishop, fooling around on stage and getting a lot of press for it. At one point, the press called them the Klan. That didn't fly very well. But it's not something that lasted, and it wasn't really an organized thing. And Frank hated the term Rat Pack.
I've read somewhere, first of all, his nights always went late, right? I mean, he would. They would meet in the. I guess they. It was sort of required by Sinatra that they all meet in the steam room somewhere. I think maybe at the.
Sand steam room, and they met there because they're all hungover,
right?
Yeah, they're hungover, and so they would sit there in the steam room at 140 degrees, whatever it was, with towels wrapped around their head, trying to sweat out the poisons of the night before.
But they're making the mob a lot of money.
Yes, they're making the mob a lot of money. The mob had a big ownership in the Sands, and Frank was always seen by the mob as a good earner, you know? Frank, unfortunately, idolized these guys. He met them early on, and we should never forget that Sinatra grew up in Hoboken, New Jersey in the 1920s and 1930s, when Italian-Americans, if you can believe this, I'm just going to put it out there, but it's the truth, were not legally considered white. Italian Americans were not legally considered white in the United States in the 1920s and 1930s, and white in that time, in that place here, was a very important thing to be. So Frank grew up as kind of a despised and condescended to minority. And when he began to perform in nightclubs, which were all owned by the guys, he came into contact with them, and many of them, most of them, were Italian Americans who Frank saw as men of power and men of respect. And so much as a little boy will idolize cowboys or football heroes, Frank idolized these guys. The relationship was asymmetrical, much like Frank's relationship with Jack Kennedy. The mob saw Frank as a great earner, as somebody, something, a commodity to be exploited, and he saw them as these powerful, honorable guys vindicating all the wrongs that had been perpetrated against Italian Americans since the beginning of the 20th century.
James, tell me, I hope you're going to tell me he really did say this. Somewhere, I remember reading this somewhere. John McClellan is the co-founder and creator of ATX Hot Sauce in all 50 states, now in several retail outlets as well. So we're going to turn it over to the social media rock chef superstar, and we're going to walk through a few sauces and why you should buy. We've done Beet Heat, so we're second in line now for the tasting. Don't forget, everyone, go to atxhotsauce.com. So here we go.
All right. So this one is our smoked habanero five pepper. We smoke habaneros with ancho, pasilla.
Is that going to hurt?
This one? No, yeah. This one's actually really, really good. Okay. This is like your traditional tapatia, but without the vinegar in it, right? And because of that fermentation process that we've talked about all the time. This one is great on sandwiches, pizzas, things like that. Great on hot wings. I think you're going to really like this one too, especially the smoky flavor with the adobo chipotle and the smoked habaneros. We actually smoked the habaneros before we...
Does that go with a cab?
This would not go with a cab. This would go with the great Chenin Blanc, though.
I teed you up with that one.
Yeah.
That is good.
That's good. It's just classic take. Well, it's a new take on a classic item. So it's called smoked habanero five pepper.
All right, don't forget atxhotsauce.com.
He was criticized for the way he lived. Needless to say, he had some issues. Needless to say, he would drink all night and was a hard drinker. At some point, he said, you correct me, and I hope you're going to say he did say it, somebody criticized him and he said, typical Sinatra, he said, you die your way, I'll die mine.
That's Frank. Frank.
Okay. Yeah.
And Frank was, in his own way, he was kind of an existentialist, you know? He was much more alone in the world than he wanted to be, but he was a man who felt deeply alone from the beginning of his life. He was an only child with a very dicey relationship with his mother, who was this volcanic force of nature, little Dolly Sinatra, under 5 feet tall. She used to beat him up sometimes when he was a kid, and then she would hug him, and he never was sure of his relationship with her or with women after that. And he was he was the loneliest man, I think, that ever was. And, yep, he said that, and he lived it.
Let's talk about the music and what went into the music. Are there songs that he hated?
Yes.
Okay.
A lot of people won't be happy to hear.
I know what you're going to say, and it's going to make a lot of people upset.
Yeah. So Frank, for instance, detested the song "My Way."
Yeah.
And this is a song that millions of people, for years and years, and continuing to this day, completely identify with Frank Sinatra, and see the words to "My Way" as being a literal word-for-word confession by Frank Sinatra of the way he had lived his life. Frank Sinatra knew it was a big song, and he loved to make hits, and so he's ambivalent about it because it made him a lot of money. But he felt it was a boastful song, and he was a guy who never felt he had to boast. He didn't have to boast. He lived it, right? Another song that he hated, and I can't tell you exactly all of the reasons why he hated it, was Strangers in the Night. He thought that was a ridiculous song, and people were always asking him to sing it, always asking him to sing My Way. And he with the doobie doobie doos. He was just making fun of it, but people love these songs.
In your opinion, the stuff that he did best, like I have this, you know, people that it's one thing to know Sinatra songs and everybody should, but to know the personality, know the drinking, know the level of depression, it feels like these introspective down and out songs, like he pours a lot into those down and out songs. They just resonate more.
Yeah, absolutely. And Frank did this amazing thing after. He really had two lives, and hence my two volumes. First one, Frank the Voice. He was a huge star during World War II. And then his career really went down the toilet after the end of the war. And he was virtually dead as a star until he had this amazing comeback with From Here to Eternity and getting signed to Capitol Records after his first label, Columbia, dropped him. So when he made the greatest comeback in show business history with From Here to Eternity, winning the Oscar for that, and then beginning this string of amazing Capitol albums, very purposefully, Frank was really the guy who invented the concept album. We talk about concept albums to this day. Sinatra invented it. And so very purposefully, intentionally, he would alternate big, swinging, bubbly, exciting, optimistic albums with deep, dark, depressive, lonely albums. First one, then the other. First one, then the other. And it worked well because he was a guy who would not be defined as the depressed, lonely guy, nor would he be defined as a superficial, always having the ring-a-ding-ding guy. And that was a big part of Frank, as was the loneliness. But musically speaking, both poles were very much hits.
Right. So I think I think of Drinking Again, which yes. just always pops out to me and always has popped out to me on yeah. Sinatra, just knowing that guy. I mean, that I feel like even though he's famous and always had loved to have people around him, right? He didn't like to be alone, but I feel like that's some level. That's that guy saying, if I wasn't a star, that's me.
And that is much in the same way that the great One for My Baby, One More for the Road, pictures Frank alone, except for the bartender,
yeah.
at 2:45, right? Knocking him back and talking to the bartender about the lost love of his life, which in Frank's case was Ava Gardner.
But then the gambling songs, or they seem to fit. I don't know, maybe it's just me with a gin martini at his family's restaurant in Vegas. It just seems to fit at the time. The gambling songs or the gambling-related songs. Did he like them?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Hell yeah. I mean, when he sang Luck Be a Lady Tonight and mimed throwing the dice,
yeah.
there's nothing as great as that.
Exactly.
That is, and Frank, I just want to take a step back and say that Sinatra is this marvelous creature of a thousand different guises and personalities. He was complex. And the first thing to know about Sinatra is not only was he this amazingly connected and influential, important figure throughout the American century, the 20th century, Frank Sinatra was also the greatest interpretive musician who ever lived. That's a big statement. I stand by it. He was the greatest interpretive musician who ever lived. He put a huge amount of effort into studying the songs that he sang. He picked the ones he wanted to sing. Yes, he wanted hits. There were some he picked that were of dubious artistic value. But for the most part, he made great music by great American songwriters, famous, and he would always talk about those songwriters. So I'm sorry I came a long way around from Luck Be a Lady Tonight, but there is the great Frank Lesser,
yep.
who wrote the music and words for Guys and Dolls. And there is Frank respecting the hell out of Frank Lesser and giving that song, that particular song, the bravura performance it deserved.
Yeah, there's so many elements to that. I actually have a pair of dice with his name on them. That's what a nerd I am.
Good to be a Sinatra.
Yeah,
nerd.
Absolutely. I was actually there for his 100th birthday celebration, which I know, I think the book came out in because of the 100th birthday celebration, which that night featured Lady, I never thought this could be pulled off, because it almost feels like Do Not Go to a Sinatra song, but Tony Bennett and Lady Gaga doing Sinatra songs. I never wanted to say that was incredible, but it works pretty well.
Well, Sinatra had huge respect for Tony Bennett.
Yeah.
Tony Bennett is a great, great singer, a very different singer from Sinatra, but Sinatra helped Bennett in his career, and really felt that in all the constellation, the small constellation of big singing stars in the 20th century, that Tony Bennett was right near the top, maybe just a notch below Frank.
You hated Ocean's 11.
Yes.
I get that. But did he?
I don't want to come across like some school teacher or scold. You know, I watched that movie with an almost perverse pleasure, right? Because it's so bad, and the relationships with women in that movie this is a movie that I would never want my wife to watch, because she give me the fishy stare and say, you're enjoying this. So it is a perversely enjoyable movie to me, but it's a movie. Listen, Sinatra hated making movies.
Yeah.
And yet despite that, when he worked with a director who he respected, and this only happened a few times, he could give amazing performances. So he gave an amazing performance in From Here to Eternity. He gave an amazing performance in The Manchurian Candidate.
Yes.
And then there were a lot of not so good movies.
Did he hate it?
Which?
Ocean's 11.
No, he thought it was a lot of fun.
Okay.
And the movie made a lot of money.
Yeah.
And as far as Frank was concerned, it was a big success. I think he was smart enough to realize it was not it was not the same universe artistically as From Here to Eternity or Manchurian Candidate, or even Guys and Dolls, for that matter,
so,
which I love.
Right. So he was not alive on the first remake with Clooney and Brad Pitt.
Correct.
Okay. Your thoughts on what he would have thought of that? Because frankly, it was pretty well done, I thought.
I love that movie.
Yeah.
I love that.
Yeah, it was pretty well done.
Oceans. I love all the subsequent Oceans movies. I love Clooney and Pitt together. I think they did a terrific job. And I think they're much better movies, especially the first one.
Yeah, absolutely.
Than the original, the OG.
What do you think he would have thought? I mean, here's Clooney trying to venture into, I mean, playing Danny Ocean, playing Sinatra anyway, period, is pretty tough to pull off. But I've got to say that Clooney probably came as close as anyone could probably do it. Be cool, understated, classic, the typical
Clooney's
Sinatra.
Terrific.
But would Sinatra have liked it?
Sinatra would have dug the hell out of George Clooney. He would have loved George Clooney. George Clooney's a movie star. When I first saw that guy on the big screen, after having watched him in ER for a while, you know, I sort of blinked in disbelief that he could, that a TV star could become such an instant movie star. But I thought, this guy is really, he's really like the second coming of Clark Gable. He looks a tiny bit like him, and he's got gigantic charisma, and the mischief and the fun between Clooney and Pitt is just incomparable. And I think Frank would have loved it.
Did Sinatra like This Town, which came later? You know, I think This Town, the song, which was, most people now only know the song because of Ocean's 11. This Town was mid to late 60s, maybe?
Which song are we talking about?
This Town, the end of Ocean's 11.
My Kind of Town? No.
I'll play. I think this is it. It's
This Town is a lonely town, not the only town.
Correct. Yeah. It is.
That's a later song that was sort of brought back to life by the remake of Ocean's 11.
That is a later song, which the producers of the latter day Ocean's movies very wisely resurrected.
Yeah.
And it is a fun swinging song.
It's a cool song.
Not a great song, but it's a fun song. And they were very intelligent to slap some life back into that thing.
Yeah, yeah. It was just where it was timed in Ocean's 11 was pretty cool. It was, I don't know if Sinatra, I mean, do you know if Sinatra liked the song or not? Because this is pretty late in his career.
Yeah, I think he sang it with great relish, and I think that he picked it for a reason. He picked it because he liked it. He thought it could be a hit. I don't think it was a particularly big hit at the time, but it was not. No, it was not on Frank's secret shit list.
Yeah. James, I could do this for a few hours. It sounds like you probably could too. I think we might end up doing this again. We'll spend the time just talking about the music, I think. But thanks for doing this. I highly recommend the books. They're fantastic. It is a deep, well done read, not just about the musician. You have another, who is it? Is it Gershwin you just did a book about? Irving Berlin, right.
Yeah, Irving Berlin, a great, great American songwriter.
Absolutely.
And one of Frank's very favorites.
Well, thanks for doing this. I appreciate it.
Thanks to you, Jeff. I enjoyed it.
Thank you. James Kaplan.
From the Hot Pie Media Studios in Austin, Texas, it's the Jeff Ward Show. Listen at jeffwardshow.com.